Morley, Chair of this committee, and I'm a city councillor of the city of Sweet Home. Jim, and then Bob, since you're in the room, and then we'll, I'll.
Jim Gorley, just at large.
You don't even know anymore, do you?
Thank you, Jim. Bob?
Bob Dalton, I'm on the Health Committee, the Parks Board, and a lot of other committees out there. So do the Health Fair, chair that. So team up a lot with Mr. Knowles and see what we can make a difference at.
Dick, and then Larry.
Good evening, everybody. Dick Knowles. As Bob pointed out, I'm part of the Health Fair and this committee. I also do a fair amount with the County Mental Health Advisory Board and also stuff with Samaritan Lynn Local Advisory Committee. Thanks.
Thank you much. Larry?
Yeah, I'm the retired superintendent here of schools in Sweet Home and part of this Health Committee. Pretty active in Rotary. I'm kind of the liaison between the Western University and some of the projects we have going with our Health Committee. And that's where I'm spending a lot of time as far as this particular committee is involved.
Thank you very much. Jeff Lynn and then Sean Morgan.
Yeah, I'm Jeff Lynn with the City of Sweet Home. I'm the Chief of Police and just participating in the meeting.
Hi, I'm Sean Morgan. I'm with the Sweet Home Police Department. I'm the Homeless Liaison and Community Services Officer and just attending tonight and listening in here. So.
Then we have Ray and Bethany.
Hi, Ray Towery, City of Sweet Home City Manager.
Thank you. Bethany?
Hi, I'm Bethany Young, and I'm the pastor of the Nazarene Church and also working with one Sweet Home with the one shelter and the unhoused in our community.
Thank you, Bethany. Welcome to joining us. And Jeff Taylor.
Good evening, everybody. Jeff Taylor, supervisor for Linn County Mental Health. I supervise child, adult, and currently our community services and supports programs in East Linn County.
Tonight, Jeff Taylor is going to be speaking to us for a few minutes about what he does and what's going on. And I'm just going to let you take it from there, Jeff, whatever you feel is necessary to touch on.
Okay, well, it's a long story, so I don't know how much time I have. I don't want to dominate the meeting. I guess I'm here because I understood that there was a question about what kind of services we have available in East Linn County, and there are a bunch of them. In fact, we have been active in East Linn County since I was a therapist here back in 1994. There's been a lot of things that I've done in between, but I've returned this time 6 years ago, started with the county as a supervisor, and I've been supervising child outpatient services for that entire time. Child outpatient services are provided primarily in schools, which, as you can imagine at this moment, is a little different. Schools don't have students on campus right now, and so we are not on campus right now. We're providing all of our services to schools via telehealth. But we do that in all the schools that we have in Lebanon and all the schools we have in Sweet Home. And somewhere along the line, the adult outpatient program changed, and I was assigned the supervisor of that. So we also have adult outpatient services for residents who live in Sweet Home in Lebanon. And just recently, we had a supervisor move on, and so I was asked to temporarily take over supervising services for what we call community services and support. Those are for people who have more chronic mental illnesses. And again, we provide those services with case managers and therapists in Lebanon and Sweet Home. We also work with a federally qualified health facility that's in Sweet Home to serve those clients with medications. So it's broad. After all of that, we also provide crisis services for the entirety of the county. So anybody who has a suicidal problem or might be dangerous to somebody else and is brought to a hospital will intervene and consult with the hospital staff. Currently, we do that in Corvallis, Albany, and Lebanon. And finally, we also have an officer, or I should say, we have a staff member who is on patrol with county officers, sort of embedded with them, and will be out on calls that are related to mentally ill people or people who are struggling with some kind of a mental illness. So as I mentioned, it's kind of broad. Around the edges of all those things, we have some other programming. I don't know how many of you have heard of the New Solutions Program or the RAP program, but we also have those services that can include case management, skills training, and those are also available to children and families in Sweet Home Lebanon, as well as Albany. What else? We don't have a basketball team. That's my attempt at humor. I heard earlier someone commenting about COVID, and one of our survival strategies around the office is to try to make things humorous if at all possible. It's very difficult. I notice many of you are masked up. I have kind of a blurred screen here, so I can't really see faces, but that's the scene at our office. Everybody wears a mask. We all take our temperature when we come to work. We practice social distancing, a lot of sanitizing and that kind of thing. So whenever possible, we keep it funny. I guess that's really all I wanted to say. I'm really curious what your questions are, though. Okay.
Lisa, we can't hear you.
Yeah, oh, sorry. I turned it off.
There we go. Okay.
Okay, so we're going to open this up to questions from everybody, but I'd like to ask you first, what do you see as the greatest challenge to serving Sweet Home?
Well, right now it's COVID. When you say serving Sweet Home, we're equipped to provide all the services I just described in that community, and to provide services in schools, to provide adult outpatient services, services to the more seriously and persistent mentally ill folk. In fact, that program actually isn't as impacted by COVID as other programs. Those folks are still treating clients face to face and providing medications, we have case managers who will go to people's homes and drop off medications to seek them out, connect services to them, you know, you name it. If you any need you can think of, from Meals on Wheels to helping them find winter clothing, those programs are currently active. Our outpatient services are limited by COVID. And so we're unfortunately unable to do anything other than telehealth right now. Our crisis team, of course, they manage anything that comes in the door, and they will do it face to face if needed. But again, it's kind of like as first responders, we need to stay in the game. And so we're being very cautious about how we contact people. Not only to protect the teams, but also to protect them. Because as our program manager put it, we're assuming everybody is got the virus, whether they're symptomatic or not. And so we need to take all the precautions that are required in order to make sure everybody's safe. So I guess that right now is the top inhibition to getting into Sweet Home.
So do you provide any non-crisis counseling?
Absolutely.
Okay. Okay.
To all the spectrum that I mentioned, children and family, okay. Adult, yes, chronically mentally ill, yes,
and we do. To access this, they would go down to the county clinic, right? Or would they be able to meet with, how many people do you have? How many hours a week do you provide for Sweet Home?
We're open 8:30 to 5, Monday through okay. Friday. A person who wants services from us just needs to call the office, and they will arrange a connection. And it's possible the therapist they're going to talk to, because we're not doing things live with people, we're doing things on the phone sometimes, we're doing things video like we're using now. They may be talking to a therapist who works out of the Albany office or the Lebanon office. Right now, the point for us is to connect with people, not to worry about the geography. So we've got therapists who will see anybody who makes a request.
I ask these questions because we have a lot of community members that are in crises that have never been in crises before. They've always been able to hang on. And with the economy and jobs, COVID, kids being at home, they're now suffering in a way that they're uncomfortable with and have never done this before. So they don't know how to manage it. And so, and they don't even know where to get these resources from. So it's good to put this out there. So
just giving us a call, the office is a good place to start.
Thank you. Sure. Anybody else?
Jim? Yeah, Jeff.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, yes. Go ahead.
Go ahead, Larry.
Okay. Jeff, I'm the retired superintendent here in the school district, and I've been out for about 5 years. Does your agency still work with the YST teams in the schools?
We do, absolutely.
Okay. Well, okay, so
again, not right now.
Well,
physically, but not. We do, yes.
You could if it was done virtually. Is that accurate or not?
Absolutely. I'm not even sure the YSTs are meeting right now. I know that we had that discussion with. So where we're at with the schools is that we are in contact with, and we're in fact at a meeting with Thad Holub and the school counseling team from Sweet Home Community Schools or Sweet Home School District, sorry, and talked over their challenges and talked about how we can fit into the needs that they have. And we're sort of having an ongoing conversation with them. I'm not even sure if the YST is meeting right now. I'm not even sure that they're gathering as a team. I know that the Lebanon district, the YST there is debating about whether they're going to do that. And it sort of comes and goes with the numbers. So yes, when we have a way to do it, absolutely. But we've had a representative on those teams for as long as I can remember.
Well, that's why I asked, because it was very effective.
Oh, okay.
Made a big difference.
Oh, well, okay, thank you.
I have one other question before I stop hogging here. Another thing when I was a superintendent was that we would actually meet with the heads of each department. All of the superintendents would meet with the heads of the department from Linn County heads. And we'd meet once a month just to talk about issues that the schools were facing. Do you know, is that still going on or not?
When you say the heads, are you talking about program manager?
There were program managers involved, but usually it was even higher up than that.
Oh, okay. So talking about so in our structure, the health administrator, top local,
excuse me,
is supervisor of our overall mental health department program manager, who's Tanya Thompson, and she would be the person who would go to something like that, or she'd assign it to me as sort of the supervisor on the ground. I think that's a great idea. To my knowledge, that's not going on.
Well, I felt it was probably one of the most effective things that we were able to accomplish when we would meet as a group. We could bring individual cases to the group and just say, all right, what services in our county can help this family, can help the student? And all the heads would, you know, give their input. And we got a lot done by having all those heads right there together.
I would be glad to participate in something like that. And I'm sure I could bring that to my supervisor and we could talk over how we could do that.
Well, I may talk to our superintendent, our current superintendent too. I've never asked him if he has attended anything like that. So I found it really beneficial.
Have you met Mr. Holub?
No.
He's terrific. I have really appreciated the collaboration I've had with him. And whenever there's been an issue or there's been a question, we have sat down together and sorted it out. Sometimes that's involved his counselors, our counselors. Like I said, we had a meeting with them. We're, of all the school districts I work with right now, that's the most active, connected district.
Very good.
To the best, I think. Yeah, they are good.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. So I see Dick's bubble is he waiting to speak? Is that what's happening with that?
He keeps getting disconnected.
Okay.
Oh, no.
Sorry, Dick.
No, that's all right. I'm back on now.
Okay.
Who's anonymous?
I don't know, actually. So that's somebody else who joined the meeting.
Who's joined us?
Yeah, it's me.
Oh, it's apparently Dick's in there twice.
Okay.
Oh, he's okay. He's on the phone too. That's why.
That's awesome. Okay, so Jim, you had some questions?
Yes. You know, as a school district, we've been talking mental health a lot, trying to come up with some ideas of what are the big drivers, how to minimize these drivers, and and what can we do to help the kids and identify this at an earlier point. One of the things we have noticed, though, over the years is that sometimes, like during the summer and things, we don't have the access to Linn County Mental Health. And is that going to change, or how can we do that? Because we went periods of times when these kids they're so spread out, they just don't have that connection after school is up, during that summertime, during the time, Christmas time or whatever. So
right, during breaks, absolutely. Yeah,
I don't think that works.
Well, I echo your sentiment. So there's pluses and minuses to what we do. By being directly attached to schools, we get access to students. Sorry, what?
It's all right. Go ahead, Jeff.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Anyway, by being embedded in schools, we get access to students at a rate we would never have had otherwise. We can talk directly with teachers and counselors and principals and whatnot to get a better feel for what's going on. And then, like you said, when school's out, and this is the downside of what we do, it's like crickets. We hang on to students as long as we can. Some of them just drop off. It's kind of like the problems disappear when there's no teacher to say, wow, this student can't sit still in a chair, or this student, you know, we had to clear a classroom because the student's behavior was the way it was, or this little girl just sits there and she's so quiet and she doesn't say anything. I'm really worried about her. When that observation goes away, oftentimes you can almost see how our productivity drops off. We are connected with the Boys and Girls Club, and that's one way we can sort of get some of these kids, but there are times when the children can't afford to be part of that. You know, they've got to charge for what they do, and I get that, but so we lose some of them that way. We have thought about like how we could connect with, if there were some districts offer programming that we could tag on to, but we're sort of stuck. We're dependent upon families at that point to bring children to us. So I get what you're saying, and I don't have a solution to that. I'd love to know what it is, but I don't have it.
So do you think that maybe during the summer when we have our summer programs, I don't know that you're tied in with those or not. Maybe we need to look at tying into some of those programs better.
I think that'd be great. So the thing about our programming is that counseling requires a space that's safe and private, you know, because we, not only do we bring children there, but we also want to bring families in. We want to bring parents to that. But yeah, I think that's a great idea, because what happens is we have a staff team that's built to handle a heavy caseload during a school year. And then what happens is when school's out, kind of like that line goes slack. And we would prefer not to have that happen, but we haven't figured out a way around that yet.
Thank you. Are there any more questions?
Well, I'd just like to kind of chime in on this. Jeff, this is Bob Dalton. And I think along the lines of the communication, that's always the challenge. Yeah, I know Dick Knowles and I have worked on numerous lists to put out in front of different organizations and people to, here's a resource available to you. And it is a challenge, and I understand what that is in this COVID time of waiting for people to come to you or any other agency for services. One of the things that we try to do is get information out to people in different media ways. Some's the newspaper, some's Zoom, some's online. One of the things we had talked about at a previous meeting was what other ways are there out there? And I know Samaritan Health Services, when you go into their office, a lot of times there's a monitor up there, just a rolling message all the time, all right, services. And I was at Bi-Mart here in Sweet Home just a few weeks ago, and I asked their pharmacist, I said, are you good with the idea of having a monitor at your pharmacy that would put resources at people's fingertips? They could see it as they're waiting. And he just thought that was a great idea to have such a service. So I'm kind of pushing those types of things out there. I think the other is, you know, even our city's website having a tab where people have a place to tab to something that's specific to what their need is. Along the lines of the school district, I've talked with Tom Yaraz, who is really open to the idea of some sort of Zoom sessions, training sessions that are social distance and small amounts offered to the teachers, to the administrators. You talked about Thad Holub. That's one I'm going to be contacting because I'm also working with Billy Cannon, who's the school district psychologist. And one of the things that that I've been working with that group is like Samaritan. And Samaritan had came back to me with an idea, and their idea is they actually put together seminars that are taped. So you can actually register and go back in and look at those seminars at your pleasure at any time, which I think is a good thought for the idea of targeting school administrators that want to tap into something on mental health or tap into sort of personal wellness to get them through this. So those are some of the platforms that we're looking at. We've got a psychologist and a psychiatrist through Samaritan that are willing to participate in that sort of a program. So, you know, as you go forward and others, I'd really encourage groups and services to think about maybe those types of formats, because that's kind of the world we live in now is people. And I think the way Tom Yaraz was looking at it is something's available, such as a seminar. He would definitely set it up where the school administrators or whatever, it's required that they go in and be really a partake in that. So Think about that as a possibility. And I think the other challenge we have here too is just connecting the dots, because we all are doing these things. I'm working on this front, Dick is working, and you on the mental health, and Jim over there. We're all kind of pulling in different directions, but for the same thing. So I think that's important. I appreciate you sharing your information. I think the more that we can do that, those dots get connected. So we're all doing the same thing and not working separately.
I have one more thing. In this COVID world, we've been doing the Zooms and things like that, but I think we're learning that maybe there's different ways of servicing people. And if we're able to get to more people through some of these services that we haven't been traditionally using before, but now it's the normal. And, you know, you have teachers out there that are teaching Zoom. You have assistants that are out there on the Zoom calls with them every day. These folks, and these are the ones that we've been talking to the school district about getting trained, all these people that deal with kids every day, they should be trained on mental health issues. But can you see this going forward as a way of maybe changing some of the stuff so we can hit more, maybe not all of it, but maybe some of the fringe areas where we can help pull people back in, where we can, I don't know, just thought.
Well, if I may, it sounds to me like what you're suggesting is that by sort of necessity being the mother of invention, we've turned to telehealth and developed some skills there and some tools there. And so the question I think you're asking is, do we just throw those away when the pandemic is over, or do we continue using those somehow to reach some of the folks that we might not otherwise get to. And you're right, that has occurred to us. The thing is, I can't tell you tonight whether we'll be allowed to do that or not. And so it certainly has, if that's what you were thinking, it certainly has occurred to me and the teams I supervise. For example, summer, it's possible that telehealth could be used to get to kids who otherwise wouldn't be able to come to the office for whatever reason. Is that where you're heading?
Yes. Yes, it is.
Yep. It's on the table. I just don't know. In our organization, for example, we've been thrown another curve. The governor has decided to, the task force has decided to close the county for a couple weeks, which is going to affect operations in a different way. So while we're doing the COVID, I don't know what you want to call it.
Angle.
Sometimes I feel like a roller coaster, you know, it takes a curve and it goes down and it goes up. It's difficult for us to plan for the future. But I definitely will bring that you brought that up at this meeting to my superiors and say, I think that's a good idea too, and see what they say.
So, I apologize. My internet went out twice. Someone may have already asked this, but Jeff, when I had emailed you, I had suggested maybe a way of identifying for us when the services are available in the various areas that you're talking about. I know the thing that comes up routinely is, and I actually suggested to you, there are people in town that don't even know that Linn County Mental Health is at the clinic at the Benton, at the FQHC. And I mean, that's a shame. You've been there a long time.
I agree with you, sir.
Yeah, that same with school. For the last 2 years, I've been hearing that every school has a counselor going in, but I don't know. I suspect it isn't every day. I suspect it isn't every other day, but I don't know what day. My guess is there is a schedule. And is there some way of, I suspect this group would like to know. It's not like we're going to plaster it on the sky, although I think Bob has the right idea that, putting it up somewhere so people know, if it's in schools, that's a little bit different. But, you know, if somebody's struggling and they stop Bob Dalton on the street and say, you know, I'm just caving in here. He doesn't know, you know, on Tuesday, you can go over to Long Street, maybe glad to help or try to help. He just doesn't know the day, nor do I.
So let me respond to that. I just want to give you a knee-jerk response to that. Everybody got a pencil?
Yep.
My number is area code 541.
Oh, you're going to be sorry.
Nope, I'm not. 541-990-4635. I will, and you can give that to anybody you want to. It's a business number, and I'll be happy to talk with you or talk with a client or whomever in order to connect somebody to our services. Glad to do that. That's one thing. Because you've seen my face, such as it is on this thing, we call it Zoom or whatever. The other thing is that I can provide you, if you give me an email address, I can provide you some more information about how to access our services and when we're around with some phone numbers. And I had hoped to bring some practitioners here tonight. I'd kind of like to do that sometime. You can see who some of the people who are doing this work. But if you give me that, I will be happy to ship you some more specifics. And then the last thing I want to say about that is, I don't know that it would be bad if you wanted to hire a skywriter to do that, put the schedule in the sky. I wouldn't complain about that at all, Dick. Really.
Well, I know a now retired health administrator who used to warn us, you don't want to be promising things that you can't actually pull off. And there's a limited number of practitioners out there. But I think we could keep them busy.
I would like to see that. Yeah.
Yeah. Me too.
Jeff, one more quick question. You talked about your superiors, and yes, it sounded like at some point, sometimes you're pushing a rock uphill. You know what is needed. Is there a disconnect from the upper administration versus a group like ourselves to hear from us versus hear from you that need?
No, I don't think so. I apologize if I gave that impression.
Sometimes I think when you're saying it, it sounds different when it's coming from us versus yourself, is what I'm saying.
I'm not sure I understand. If I get the question, it sounds like you'd like to talk with Tanya Thompson, who is my immediate supervisor. Is that right?
Well, no, I'm not necessarily. I'm just saying, you know, sometimes say I was asking for some money from a group and they said, well, what do you need money for? And then I said, well, it's because I need this money to do this work. But yet when I have Jim Gurley and these individuals sitting around and said, this is the reason we want to do this, because it's kind of like the putting the mental health
logo out there
for people to read. You're saying you need it more, and we're in a small community. And we're saying, no, we do need this. This is why we need this. So it supports what you're trying to accomplish. It's just we're the ones that's helping you push that. Does that make sense?
I get you now. I get where you're coming from now. Yeah. I think so. Here's what I think we should do. And I don't know how much time you have, what your agendas are like, you know. What I'd like to do is report back. I'd like to have a chat with my supervisor and then come back at some point and tell you what she said. So the other thing is, I'm not seeing holes. And so I might be missing something. I'd like to hear from you folks where you feel the holes are, because from where we're standing, we've got players on the field who are ready to go with the referrals that you might have. And I see some things. Wow, there's some stuff popping up on my screen here. I don't know what that's about, but I might be missing the holes that you feel there are. And so I'll go talk to my boss, and if you could tell me what the holes are. Wow, this is starting to pixel.
I got you. I'm here.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I think she'll be nothing but receptive. And like Dick said, don't promise the sky, right?
Sure.
But I do want to say that we're here to serve Sweet Home, you know.
Yeah.
Jeff, if I might, Jeff Taylor, that is, we have a Jeff Lynn. That is part of the problem. People do not know when I ask, and I'll verify, you literally to Bob, you could literally email Tanya Thompson and get the same answer. Here's my phone number. Call me if you have trouble. But there is a difference in just process and protocol and that sort of stuff that you can't ignore that. But it's an ongoing problem, and it's not just in Sweet Home, that it is not clear how one gets to the services. So because of what I've been involved with, I can sit in a mental health advisory board meeting and have you guys actually come in every month or so and tell us what's going on. I can, I can verify that you're more handsome in person than you are on Teams or whatever. But that's not true of the usual typical community member. And that's why I was kind of pointing out that I can tell them, yes, there are services at Longstreet, but they don't know when or where, things change. Mr. Gorley's true, not everything's the same the way it was 8 months ago, and it's certainly not the same way it was 2 years ago. The whole access thing, you could just walk in off the street, 6 months ago. You still have it. But now Tanya will tell you sometimes you have to wait because there's just not enough people to help. It's an honest answer. It's not a three-month. Okay. It's not a three-month wait like it was. I can play, and most of us can play with a couple of weeks because of a pandemic. But it's really not clear that there's any services offered. How many are offered at Samaritan Clinic? How many? That kind of stuff. So I will email. I'll ask. But yes, do go ahead with and ask Tanya. Kind of give her synopsis of what we've done tonight and come up with some clarity.
Ray, could you distribute our emails to him and have him send out a message to us, and then we can get back to him with him send an email to us. And
Ray, you're muted.
So you want me to share all of your email addresses with Mr.
with
Taylor?
Him or share his email with us if he sends it to you?
Actually, it was Jim. I think it was on the invites. It was a CC and all of our names. I don't know if Bethany's was there.
Oh, mine comes with just my name on it. And so.
Well, I got two of them and one of them had everybody, but yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, whoever, that works.
I have the original invite, and Ray or I will send out to everybody contact information.
Okay. So, Lisa, the thing you forwarded to me today from Brandon has everybody's on there, I believe.
Yeah.
Okay, because I only saw 7 on that one that's why I asked you about it.
Well, yeah, those are the people who are physically on and here tonight.
Okay.
It's got yours, both Jeff's, Dr. Horton, Sean Morgan.
Does that have Bethany?
At CenturyTel, who is that?
That's me, Dick.
So the one we're missing would be, Bethany is not on that list. Okay. Bethany, can I steal your email address from you real quick?
She just wrote it in her.
I just put it in the chat.
She's got it in the chat. Yeah.
There we go. I believe Chief Lynn had a question, or at least had his hand raised at one point.
Yeah.
I did, but it was really probably a moot point. I mean, you asked about some of the services lacking, and from my standpoint, I would say some of the crisis responsibilities is with one person basically doing the crisis liaison response for the county makes it kind of tough to get to get her out here in times of need. But I know that has been a topic with Tanya, Justin, and they've had meetings with other law enforcement agencies as well. So it is on the topic, but that I still think is one of the key components that, from my standpoint, we're missing out here.
So, Jeff, do you think that if we only have one person responding to these things, if they were able to do it by Zoom or something, in an emergency, because sometimes they're kind of an emergency. Is that something you could have somebody other than her and then her going to the spot? Or I don't know how that would work.
I don't think that'd be enough in a crisis.
I'm just trying to figure out if you only.
And I'm not sure which Jeff you're asking.
Either one of you. I'm just trying to figure out how this would work, because you're.
Well, from my standpoint, somebody in that type of crisis, a Zoom would seldom be as effective.
I guess what I'm thinking is you might be able to talk to somebody long enough for somebody to get there. If you're talking about that big of a crisis, I don't know.
The other way around.
What is it?
I think I understand what Chief's trying to say. And what I need to do with that question is take it back to my supervisor. And just say that I asked folks to identify holes, and what he said was, one person doing liaison makes it tough to get to you when you need them. Mm-hmm. And then I heard the question, could this be done by Zoom? And there's a discussion about that, which is sort of a discussion we've had about crisis. Can you really do that by Zoom? But that's a question I'm going to have to put to her. And I don't think I don't feel like I'm pushing a rock uphill, but I don't know how much elasticity there is in the program right now to do that. I don't know. I'm going to find out for you, though.
Well, and I know previous conversations, it does come back to money. That's additional staff and money somewhere along the lines.
And one of the problems you've got is distance, to be fair. Mm-hmm. That's quite a ways for them to respond to you. But yeah, it's money. and it'll probably be more problematic.
So, Jeff, the people that are, and this is Jeff Lynn, in Sweet Home, the people are typically in crises, and we see people repeatedly that are at greater risk than other people. Is that something to where that we had a routine to where that they were contacted on a regular basis with Zoom, that we might be able to eliminate some of those blowouts? If they're just checking bases and they could see a face, a familiar face, that, and it's on a regular schedule, the people that you're dealing with, would you think we would see a result if Jeff Taylor's people could do that?
I think that's a difficult question to answer because a lot goes into that. Some who we have contacts with regularly wouldn't be able to follow through or access some of those Zooms without somebody going there and initiating that. And then a lot of it, we're back to that same personnel aspect of it, if that makes any sense to you. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying it wouldn't, it wouldn't be at all useful, but I think the majority of the time, those cases that I'm referring to when somebody's in the crisis, that it would not be as useful.
Okay.
How many of those people are homeless?
There'll be a percentage of them, absolutely.
Yeah, we're finding that homeless people have a harder time doing this.
So,
how many, may I ask another question though? How many of those folks are going to have a mental disorder? What do you think? What percentage would you say?
Well, I think if you combine that with alcohol and drug, it's pretty high. I'm going to guess.
It's pretty high.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we could still, I mean, we would still, as an agency, be interested in serving them. That would be our intent.
Oh, without a doubt. Yeah. It's getting them to there and getting that, them to follow through and mental health to follow up, and all those things need to come into play.
So this is another question, and maybe or maybe not, I don't know how this is, but Sean, I know you're listening. But
I'm here.
Do you carry like a laptop or a some sort of a device with you when you're out talking to the homeless folks? And if you see somebody that maybe is in crisis, can you could you help them get on something where they could talk to somebody? Or I mean, is that even a thing?
Well, if I'm understanding correctly, like crisis, we have one who I think about 3 months ago, maybe 4 months ago, one homeless person who was very loud, yelling at different locations throughout town during the day, and we had officers out there. The chief was out there. I ended up out there as well, and we did make contact with the liaison who got involved. But that was a long process. We were a couple hours into that. And, in general, what I find, I don't generally find folks in crisis in like an acute crisis, because they're kind of always in some kind of crisis, some kind of chronic crisis. What I'm finding today, especially where we've got the community court going, is, mental health is extremely, has been really stepped in real strong with these homeless folks. Just today, I talked to one talking about wanting to get some mental health help. I said, hey, let's make a phone call. And I just called him literally 3.5 hours ago and set up an appointment for this Friday. I'll help him get to that appointment to make sure it happens. Since I'll be out in that area, I scheduled it in a time that I'll be available to help him with it. I do carry a phone, and I have had these guys on the phone with mental health, just talking that way if we have to. I ensured today that two folks will be able to make it to a mental health appointment in Lebanon on Thursday. Actually, Chance made sure that happens. They'll get the ride there. And so there's a lot of organizations really working together really hard. Shane Maddox at Linn County Mental Health has absolutely been outstanding interfacing with me on this stuff. What I'm curious about is whether we can – that difficulty that Jeff Lynn is bringing up here is, I'm constantly watching these schedules, keeping track of their schedules, trying to keep these guys, make sure they get to these appointments, make sure they know they got them, make sure they got rides set up. But if there's a mechanism to have them meet locally here on a regular basis, you know, if their schedules can kind of be aligned, that might be an interesting way to solve it, where we can have them here on a single day. I don't know if that's possible or not, but that's a thought I was having as I'm hearing some of this. But crisis level responses, I haven't had to get into that too much, other than that one instance that I could think of.
Where are they transporting to? Are they going to Lebanon?
1600 South Main on Thursday.
Why are they transporting Sweet Home people to Lebanon?
That's where they're meeting. And that's an issue I constantly run across, because it's difficult enough to make sure that they, you've got an appointment today, and some of them are, you have so many issues that that's a difficult task in and of itself. And then I've got to figure out transportation. Someone has to figure out transportation for them. And thank goodness for Chance and anybody else who steps up, because a number of people have. I'm trying to get a guy, make sure he gets to a medical appointment on Saturday, because I'm busy, and that's, someone else is working on that, and I'm hoping that happens. But I don't know why they're meeting in Lebanon, but that's where they're going.
Do you think it would be possible for us to have a conversation after this meeting? Because I'm curious.
I would love it.
I'm new to supervising this. It sounds like this might be somebody who falls in the chronically mentally ill kind of category.
Uh-huh.
I'm new to supervising that team, but we do have therapists who are, their task is to serve the Eastland County area. And I don't get why we're having to bring clients from Sweet Home to Lebanon. I don't understand that.
This particular client has needed in the past to go to Lebanon to get medication on a regular basis. And since then, this client has made other arrangements, but we've wondered why we can't get the shot here in town at times. We're like, why is this not possible? So it's a good question.
I'd like to ask that question from inside our organization.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Yeah, no, you've got my number. I think it would be, I'd be curious to pick your brain a little bit more about how that works, since you're doing a lot of that work and you're arranging it a lot. I just don't get why that's happening. So
I'm calling you tomorrow.
Okay.
That's in my calendar. Right? It's in my calendar, 8:30 a.m.
Okay. Now that'll be interesting, because I'll be sitting down I'll be doing a Zoom meeting with the CSS team.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, make that call. We'll see how that flies.
Okay.
Do you know what? What's your number?
Oh, losing you.
Put it in the chat function, Sean.
Yeah. I can put it in my contacts, but it's stuck in a that's not him file. You know what I mean?
There we go. It's in the chat now.
And I'm aware of it. I've hogged up a lot of your time, folks.
Oh, no. This,
jeez, I feel bad
this
about
is
that.
The topic that we have. We have multiple entities here and people who work on subcommittees, and our focus is community health. And so we are excited to have you here and this conversation. We meet the third Wednesday of every month at 6:00, and you are always welcome to join us. So when you want to bring your other folks with you, please do. Please do. Okay. So at this point, we'll go through the list of committees, and at the end we will have each person with us tonight, in person or virtually, do a report on what they're working on, what's going on, what their needs are, and have those discussions really quickly. We start off with the Community Health Fair Committee, and I know you don't have a lot going on, but you had been asked about the mental health function, and you've been working with the school district and getting that out into the community. And I think it'd be a good time to report, because that's what you're working on during COVID, right?
Yeah, and I can just kind of read you a little bit about what I talked about earlier with what Samaritan is kind of offering up to help us move forward. And the email I received is,
was with COVID-19 cases still on the rise, Samaritan has begun offering some classes and events virtually, including our Healthy Minds, Healthy Body series. These are health education seminars where the content is geared towards the public and the community members. It's held on Microsoft Teams platform and can be interactive. The session is recorded and sent out to registrants after the event so they may refer back to the information at any time. I know your focus is on Sweet Home, but the series would open it up for all counties, Lynn, Benton, and Lincoln. So what they were asking me there was, please let me know if you're interested pursuing the options. Look at the dates. And it's usually held during the lunch hour and lasts 45 minutes. So they've already got kind of a time slot they're offering up. So right now it's coordinate that back with Tom Yarez and the school district, what they're willing to offer up. Coordinate it with the school psychologist and Thad Holub, kind of see if we can coordinate this effort to pull this one off. And we're doing that really, the process was to begin with mental wellness. What can we do to offer people access to information that starts at this bottom level of, you know, teachers that are dealing with online trainings, students, you know, not having those face-to-face in classroom, just that whole aspect of it's taken its toll, you know, on everyone, from the parents to the students to the frontline people to the educators. So we're trying to put something together that they have access to on a regular basis. So that's really what I'm working on right now. And it's just right now, it's a matter of sitting down, letting them say, here's what we want to do. So.
Okay, nice. Well, it's farther than where we were at. And yeah. So is there any questions, discussion? Okay, thank you. The next one is Western University, Larry Horton.
Okay, I will take it over for a few minutes. Here, the Western University students will be focusing on basically one project, and that is the mentoring program. There are 10 students from Western University that are going to be working once a week with 20 students from the high school. They are enrolled in a program called MIKE, and I'm not for sure what the acronym stands for, but it's basically a career identification and a career familiarity with the students helping, the Western University students helping the high school students get to learn a little bit more about different types of career possibilities in the medical field. They will be doing different projects each week. They are doing it through Zoom, and so it's a little bit different than what they have done in the past with this type of a program. So it's new, it's going to be exciting. The high school students, from what I understand, are very excited about it, and the college students are just elated to be able to work with the kids. They've asked me to try and locate different professionals in the medical field in our area, and I've contacted probably four or five so far that have agreed to speak with the students. They will be doing different exercises of some dealing with food, some dealing with exercise, some dealing with different health issues in the community. It's going to be a pretty well-rounded program in which the kids will get a very good introduction to a lot of possible careers in the medical field. So I'm hoping what it's going to do is open a lot of doors for our Sweet Home students into the medical field so that they really feel like, you know, they could become a nutritionist, they could become a dietitian, they could become a doctor, a nurse, a dentist, any number of opportunities within the medical field. So that's where the kids are going to be spending most of their time this year, the students from Western University. They've decided to just focus on the one area. So that's where we are.
Thank you very much. If you have any questions.
Yeah, Mr. Taylor, I believe you had your hand up first there.
Oh, I was just going to say that if any of your students are interested in interviewing or talking with a mental health provider, a child and family therapist, I'm sure we could arrange that.
I am going to pass your name and your phone number, Jeff, onto them. And they probably will be contacting you. So thank you very much. That's greatly appreciated.
Yeah.
And Mr. Knowles, I believe you had a question as well. You muted yourself.
Yep, can't hear you, Dick.
Yeah, you answered it. I don't need the question. Thank you.
Okay, very good.
Bethany?
I didn't have any questions, no.
Okay, thank you. I saw your bubble, so I thought maybe that was you. Is there anybody else who has their hand up?
No.
Okay. Did you have your hand up?
Well, Larry, can you, to blow your own horn here a little bit, and Western University, would you explain their whole process with getting that format that they could use?
The MIC program, is that what you're talking about? Yes. Or just how they got, you know, the whole thing started around a survey that was done with community members about two, three years ago. And mentoring was one of the major topics that came out of those surveys. And so different projects have been worked on by the university students over the past 2 years. And this third year, they decided that if they were going to be effective at all, they wanted to pick just one area. And the students at the Western University were most excited about the mentoring program. And this was all started in cooperation with this committee and with Di Lacey at Western University. Di had a really good friend that started this MIC program, which is a mentoring program. It's been very successful up in the Portland area. It's actually normally a charge. There's a cost to the program. But thanks to Di and her connections with the person that started the program, we're getting the program here in Sweet Home for no cost. So she's actually wanting to see how it works as a pilot in a rural school district. She's only worked in big school districts in the past. So we are kind of a project for the person in charge of it.
Nice. Thank you. Ray's got his hand up.
Yeah. Speaking of leadership programs, we were awarded a grant from the county. Rose and Counselor Gerson are kind of heading up this program, and it's offered through RDI. It's actually the program from the Ford Family Foundation. I think, Larry, I believe you're an alumni of the Ford Family Foundation Leadership Program. Is that correct?
Or twice.
What was that?
I've been there once or twice, yes.
Yeah. So this program came out from under the Ford Family Foundation, and when their staff left, and is now with Rural Development Initiatives. So they're starting to do that training now. I think I'm going to mispronounce his last name. Is it Bascom, who's the counselor at the junior high now?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
He will be one of the trainers, along with several other people from the community as well. So it's an opportunity that just kind of jumped right in our lap when the county put out the youth grants a little while ago, about a month or so ago, 2 months ago. So some additional leadership options for kids as well. This one will be targeting younger groups, though, more of the junior high age, a little bit younger than what the MIC program is after, though, from what I gather. So
that's great.
Sounds good, though. Yeah, the more leadership training, those types of programs that we can bring to our kids, the more doors it's going to open for them in the future. So yeah. Kudos to Diane and Rose.
Yeah.
That is exciting. Okay, thank you. Is there any more questions? Okay, so we're moving on to the Hero Banner Project real quick.
84, I believe, is what we have. And they're almost out to foster, but I'm looking at taking them down, cleaning them up, and putting them away for the winter. So I'm going to be doing that, getting ready for next year.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions? Okay. And then we'll go through committee reports. So, Dick, did you have anything you wanted to share? I know you've been working with Bob on the ones. You're on mute. Dick, you're on mute.
I'm typing and talking.
Sorry.
Leave it to me. I just thought before the meeting, just to share with the group that the medical bus and or mental health bus that Samaritan has been providing has been put on hold somewhat indefinitely. I think the COVID thing has happened on top of the fact that the cost to repair the bus is going to be somewhat substantial. To be fair, I think they're just taking a deep breath and see how much funding they have available after this pandemic thing pans out. So those things are on hold. I didn't have anything else.
Thank you, Dick. Any questions? All right.
Yes. So, Dick, we're if you can get any kind of idea on what's going on with the bus, let us know. If you can pass that information on, we might be able to bring it in and help out with it. I'm not sure. I'm going to guess it's a diesel bus, in which case I'm not sure about what our mechanic can and can't do with it. But I can tell you otherwise that the guy we have is just pretty much amazing. So we might be able to help Samaritan with that if they want to get in contact with me.
I will suggest that this is a bus that goes from Lincoln to Benton to Sweet Home, and I think they had a major overhaul look at Benton, but I'll bring it up. I'll just suggest it to them. It's a nice gesture. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Okay. So, Chief Lynn?
Well, I will defer to Sean Morgan, who does the majority of our outreach, and maybe you can talk some about efforts with the homelessness.
Thank you. Sean? Sean, are you on?
He's muted, Sean.
Are you muted?
Oh, I flipped my switch on my headphones and didn't unmute myself. Sorry. So Bethany, I invited Bethany to speak to us tonight about it. She's really the point on kind of taking the point on the homelessness front. I'm here to kind of support that and the efforts there. But she's been making some headway on a number of things, particularly with a homeless shelter. So Bethany.
Hi, Bethany. Thank you for joining us.
Hi. Yeah, Sean called me this afternoon and said, the meeting's tonight. Are you ready? So so I just kind of threw something together to kind of fill you in on where we're at. I don't know how many of you know that the shelter has been kind of running for the last 2 years. The One Sweet Home organization kind of launched it in alliance with Pastor Joe Medley and a couple volunteers. And did some research as to what they can do, and they kind of threw it together that first year to keep some of the unhoused warm through that winter. And then last year it ended up at my church, kind of as a last ditch, like they were begging at the last moment. And so we said, okay, we'll open the doors, you run it, and didn't have a lot of involvement at that point. And then because we were opening our doors when it was cold, we got to know some of the homeless and some of the process. And then COVID hit, right? So that kind of threw a kink into everything. And it actually shut the shelter right before the last 2 weeks of really cold weather we had this last spring or late winter, early spring. And so the homeless ended up kind of in my little porch area that's kind of covered and out of the wind, and asked if they could stay there to stay as warm as they could since we couldn't let them in because they showed up to get in after being there all winter, right? And so they kind of started showing up there. We had two or three originally, and then we ended up with four or five pretty regularly, and kind of expanded where they started showing up. And then they kind of stuck around during spring and summer with COVID going on, and the Eastland Ministry street team that comes out kind of encouraging them to stay put. And so they kind of stuck there and started making me nervous. So I called Chief Lynn and I said, I don't think this is within the ordinances, but we want them to be safe and where we can kind of keep track of them. Are we okay? And he was like, for now. So then we ended up with fires and everything going on around us with the smoke. And they ended up with tents to try and get them out of the smoke. And they kind of never got rid of the tents at this point. So conversation has been happening since about mid-April about what are we going to do for the next extreme weather shelter for winter, right? Because you had to plan ahead, especially with COVID going on. And there were three or four meetings that happened and some conversation. And some of you guys were in some of those meetings and without any real direction about where we were going to go. And I'm sitting in those meetings because I have them living in my backyard. So knowing what some of the needs are, getting to know some of the people that are out there, having conversations, love listening to Jeff tonight about mental health and just brainstorming, like, what can we do? How can we help that clientele? Because mental health is a big issue. So started putting together this plan and idea. And then in comes Sean as part of the conversation and as the community liaison. And so we were having this kind of conversation of how do we work with the city, within the ordinances, within the community to help this group of people that definitely needs help at this time. And how do we do that the right way? Including conversations about we need mental health in place, we need recovery and rehabilitation stuff in place, we need advocates for these guys to help them get like IDs and birth certificates, and we don't want them to just camp out in my backyard for the rest of eternity. That's not our plan. But the immediate need is how do we keep them warm? And then the bigger need is how do we move forward from there and how do we transition that out of, you know, Main Street front corner as everybody comes into Sweet Home homeless camp. That's not what we want. That's not our goal. So how do we work through that? And so right now with COVID and then now with the new government issue of we're shutting back down, right? How are we going to keep these guys warm in these interesting times that we're in? And so that became the question of the day. We don't have a space or a shelter space in Sweet Home big enough to meet COVID standards for this winter. And so it became a question of, okay, they can't come in. So what can we do to keep them from freezing to death? And so the conversation became kind of this like Arctic camp. And so through several conversations, several things that were happening, talking to the volunteers from last year, most of them are out because of health issues and not wanting to be involved with the COVID. And so it ended up being a conversation where Bethany's like, well, we're managing it now, so I guess I can step into that role of managing the process. And then having that conversation with One Sweet Home saying, hey, can we bring this back under your guys' umbrella? And having that kind of unit to be able to have donations and stuff like that come in. This is kind of our plan. This is where we're headed. So immediately we're looking at extreme weather. Unfortunately, the word camp is being tossed around and I don't like that word, but this transitional space, right? Where we can keep them warm. We can keep them self-isolated. We can keep them sheltering in place, trying to meet the COVID rules and being able to access them if needed to be, if we are having health issues or things going on throughout the winter. So through end of February, first part of March, what does that look like? And so put in a plan for Arctic camping, basically, which is a tent and a sleeping bag and an air barrier that'll keep them, help keep them warm. And since we started having that conversation, talked to Blair at the city, talked to Sean a lot extensively, working with the street ministry teams that are coming in, working with some of the mental health and advocates coming in. How can we do this? How can we check on them? How can we work with this? And how can we keep contact as little as possible? So we're not, if somebody does get COVID, we're not spreading COVID around. So, since that conversation started, We have raised funds. We have received donations for everything that we needed to do an extreme weather camp in excess. So we're actually moving into now conversations about transitional property, a different space. Where is it going to go? How are we going to bring these services? Like, how can we answer this question of mental health services without them going to Lebanon or Albany to get those? Can we have a hub? Can we have advocates and social workers and mental health providers and maybe even medical care like the Samaritan bus or something like that that can come to one location where these people that need the services are regularly and that we can help transition them from being on the streets, high mental health, psychoticness, whatever is happening in their lives, getting them to one space that's safe, secure and simple so that we can help walk them through that transition. That's not going to happen overnight. We all know that when you're dealing with mental health, when you're dealing with drug addiction, when you're dealing with whatever put you on the street in the first place, it's a very long period of time. And so while we're getting through extreme weather, we're working on this plan so that by March, we're hoping that we've got more of a transitional plan in place and with the city and working within ordinances and working within all those things that need to happen, getting all the pieces and parts kind of put together and making it look better as we move forward and getting some of that health and mental health and rehabilitation in place so that we're not just seeing them on the corner and thinking, oh, what are we going to do about that? But we're actually working towards a solution to a problem that's a very long-term problem. And so some of that is working with Sean, getting some volunteers trained, getting through some of those like trauma care classes and mental health CPR, knowing what to do when somebody's out in the street screaming and hollering and throwing their arms around instead of being upset or worried that they're going to hurt us, knowing that it's something that can be handled and dealt with differently than maybe we have before. And so that's kind of where we're at. Some of the questions that have been asked is how can we help? I think being part of the committee, some of you guys are actually in those conversations, helping us know what those things are, like what the health groups are, what the mental health can do, where those teams come from, where the advocates come from, and be willing to be in those meetings and have conversations. And honestly, if somebody knows how to write language to bring to the council and work on that, that would be amazing. I'm new at this. This is like, it just landed in my lap. And I love that I'm having a lot of community support and a lot of, I've had support from areas that I didn't expect to get support. Let's put it that way. And I'm super excited about the idea that if we can work in this small little group that we have right now, then are we going to be able to reach some of those families that were talked about with the educational system and some of these different areas that they're homeless, but they're not living on our street corners, right? So how do we help them transition back into life as well? And that would be the big picture plan. So it's not, we're focusing on this little small group to kind of get a plan in place and moving forward, but working with all these different agencies and getting to where we can move forward and bring in the school district and help move through that and maybe help Sweet Home move forward as well out of this kind of generational poverty mindset and place that they're stuck in a lot of cases. So what does that look like? How do we do it? You guys have been doing it for a long time, so I'm all ears, and I'm excited to be able to work with you guys and be part of this community and help as much as we possibly can from our little corner of the community.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And I absolutely agree. We have a generational poverty mindset. And we need to help break through that and continue that process, even though we're stuck in COVID. Questions?
Well, I was just going to say that you said that they're not living on the street, but they're not living on the street yet. And if we can get to them at this point, then maybe they won't be living on the street. But if we don't, then that's that yet.
Any other questions?
Sean Morgan.
Sean?
Yeah, so just to add a little bit about what I've been doing, I'm continuing to work with the I alluded to it all before. I'm continuing to work individually with them. I'm tracking schedules. We have a tremendous number of them between the work I've been doing and then the community court, especially bringing that to bear, where we're getting a lot of these folks into a lot of the treatment that they need, at least in the conversations, and they're getting some intake. One gentleman has applied for a job and is just waiting to hear back on, he's basically at a dead end right now, waiting for things to happen. He's done everything we've ever asked of him. And, now we have he needs an income of some kind, and he needs to go through a housing process to get into something. And that's a frustration here. Because he's done every single thing we've asked him to do, and he's months, I don't know how far away he is from housing. But a lot of these folks are, they're engaging services between, this work I'm doing and especially the influence of the community court. Some folks I didn't expect to engage some services very quickly or easily. So that's kind of a cool thing that's going on out there.
That's great. Thank you.
Mr. Towery.
Ray.
Yeah, I just want to reiterate what a great job Sean is doing. I got to spend some time with Bethany 2 weekends ago in the One Sweet Home event. And this is exactly the model that is working in other places as well, of helping people get through programs, connecting people with resources on an individual basis, resources that are already there. And again, this is the model that when you go out and you read and find places that have been successful, this is what they're doing. And I just want to give kudos to Sean for jumping in with both feet. Jeff brought him on board in June, and Sean has done everything to hit the ground running. So thank you very much for that, Sean, and we really appreciate the work that you're doing.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. I would echo that as well for Sean and for Bethany. I'd also say that Saturday morning we have a work party, if anyone cares to join us, at the Nazarene Church at 9:30 to try and build some platforms to help get these homeless people off the ground. We'd love to have as much help as we can get.
And what do you need them to bring, Larry?
Probably a driver of some kind, not a screwdriver, but a drill that can drive screws, deck screws. That's really what we need, along with muscles. So the wood itself, all of the materials are being donated by CTC, and the Rotary Club is picking up the cost of all the deck screws. And we're hoping to have a fairly decent work party and spend 2 or 3 hours and knock out 20 platforms so that the people that are there at Bethany's parking lot will at least be able to get off the ground, stay dry, stay a little warmer.
And it is at a church, so we can have how many outside?
25, I think.
Yeah.
50 is that right, outside. Jeff? 50.
50
outside.
Yeah.
Well, I'd love to see 50. I'll be happy if we get 10.
Yeah.
50 would be great, though.
Okay. This is phenomenal.
Larry, you said 9:30, is that correct?
9:30.
Bethany, you are welcome to join us anytime. We're glad to hear from you. Thank you, Larry, for the report on the platforms and Sean and all the reports that everybody's having tonight. It's awesome. At this point, is there anybody that would like to bring up anything else or questions that we haven't answered? Any more discussion?
Anything? I would just like to thank Jeff Taylor for his openness and his willing to try and help Sweet Home. It's very encouraging, Jeff, the words that we heard from you tonight.
Absolutely. We really appreciate you being here.
I know this isn't health related, but it kind of is. and I'll probably be getting a hold of everybody individually about doing some lighting for some of the businesses and maybe some dress up in the town. So if you see my phone number, I'm looking for help maybe.
On the lighter side, he's referring to the fact that we have had a very sucky year. It's been horrible for everybody, and we've just came out of a political climate that was very difficult for people, and the holidays are coming up, and the best thing we can do for Sweet Home is to turn on the lights, the Christmas lights downtown, and decorate the best that we can so that our children, when they get in the cars with their parents, they can drive through town and feel good about Sweet Home. The adults can feel good about Sweet Home. And so anybody who wants to come down and help with that effort, you are all welcome to join us and support those businesses and churches and homes and just feel good through the holidays. We have a month to spend at home anyway, so we might as well do a good job at it. And we will be socially distancing and working in cohorts, but the goal is to make Sweet Home beautiful for the holidays. So that's what he's referring to. Anything else? With no more business before us, the meeting is adjourned.
Thanks, everybody.